What's going on, everybody? It's time to check out a brand new artist to the channel, brand new artist to me. This is Tate McRae. I certainly hope I'm saying that right. Gotten quite a few requests to check out Tate McRae. Ironically enough, I'm going to see Shawn Mendes, one of my favorite humans, artists in the entire world, as you all probably know by now. I'm going to see him on tour a couple times, at least twice. And both of the shows I plan to go to, she is opening for Shawn. So this works out. I'll get a bit of a Tate preview before I see her live and in person. So very soon, actually. In the meantime, let's give ourselves a little bit of a preview to Miss McRae. Let's Wikipedia this bad boy. Tate Rosner McRae is a Canadian singer, songwriter, and dancer. At the age of 13, she gained prominence as the first Canadian finalist on the American reality TV show So You Think You Can Dance. I totally remember that show. Never really watched it, but I remember that show. Interesting. McRae caught the attention of RCA Records in 2019 after her original song, One Day, which was in 2017. Interestingly enough, we're in 2022, and I believe this is her debut album we're about to listen to. So 5 years later, since she went viral, she's releasing the album. I think that's kind of a good amount of time. You know, she didn't rush right into it. Subsequently releasing her debut EP, All the Things I Never Said, which came out in 2020. McRae soon gained wider recognition after her song You Broke Me First became an international hit in 2021. McRae was the youngest musician featured on Forbes 30 Under 30 list. I gotta check that list out, actually. I've never looked at that. Wait, musician on Forbes, is that everyone that's 30? Like a list of 30 people under 30, just musicians or people in general? Either way, it's a sick list to be on. I'm gonna look at that list. I might make a video for that list, actually, interestingly enough. Her second EP, Too Young to Be Sad, interesting title there, was the most streamed female EP of 2021 on Spotify. Wow, that's a huge deal. I didn't know she was pulling these kinds of numbers. Okay. Her debut studio album, I Used to Think I Could Fly, was released on May 27, 2022. The album was met with positive reviews from critics and reached the top 10 in various countries while entering at number 13 on US Billboard. I'm excited. I hope you're all excited. Tate McRae, I Used to Think I Could Fly. Let's do this. Leave it to Shawn to show Canadian talent some love, right? All right. I Used to Think I Could Fly. I'm ready for this. I love the title, by the way. I love, adore an album title that gets you thinking. You know, I used to think I could fly. Sort of makes me think that she used to think she was indestructible, or she's sort of conflicted with her feelings of what she felt like her own limitations were over the years, and whatever way you want to say that is, like, emotionally, there's some clear growth in the concept of I Used to Think I Could Fly, and that obviously being a metaphor for this other feeling. So that being said, I'm ready. First track, this question mark looks like it's a bit of an intro. Let's get started, Tate.
Friends, you're suddenly scared of things that you were literally never scared of before. And when I was younger, like, I used to think I could fly.
Okay, so there it is. It's just the accompanying fear that is pretty automatic when you become an adult. And she said it better than I could have possibly said it, and it's because she's had that vision in her mind. Yeah, I love that's such a cool way to sort of jump us into the album and this feeling of going from, you know, adolescence and growing into an adult and everything that comes with that. So yeah, you just think about the worry-free way that you used to go about living, you know, when you were a child, and just the lack of worries that you had in comparison to certainly the emotions and responsibilities that come with getting older. Good start. Don't come back, track two. Back when you see that I'm better off, when you all broke down and you're missing us, when you finally figure out just what you lost.
Of course.
Yeah, you're making excuses trying to come back. First time I've ever heard her sing ever is this song right here, Don't Come Back. And as she's beginning and as she's sort of getting into the song, I'm thinking, okay, she can sing, obviously. Then I'm thinking she's got some spunk to the way she sings. She's got some spunk to her voice, and it's like a very particular characteristic about her voice. But then, like, there's a lot of spunk in the tone of the song, talking about, you know, don't think you're going to be able to come back. You know, you can go ahead and blame it on alcohol. You can make your excuses, like you're not getting that second chance. Like, once you realize, you know, you fucked up, and once you realize, like, what you missed out on, don't think you're just going to come back. But, like, she's got spunk in the way she sings that. There is a direct melody lineup here to me from this song. Go ahead and lie to me, throw it all out now, this fall with me. There it's there. Alright, let's go to I'm So Gone.
Don't be calling my name when I'm so gone. I hope that you hate it. Never left your dad's basement. Now you're mad that I made it.
Oh,
don't be calling my name when I'm so gone. I hope that you hate it.
You could have gone big right there, but you kept it subtle. I'm so glad you made that choice right here.
Did you hate it?
No. Keep it quiet. Today. You promised that the two of us would fade. Isn't it funny how you say that after pushing me away? Used to say you needed something new. Now you're back cause I'm good without you. When you had her options, all your bitches find that all you do is lie. Oh, I don't think you're gonna get a second try. When what?
You had her options, all your bitches find that all you do is lie.
Oh. That's one of my favorite lines that I've heard this year. Don't Come Back and I'm So Gone kind of are sister songs to one another. They feel like they tell a lot of the same story, but they're both so smooth, right? I go into this, and for like, in my head, I'm just like, okay, are we gonna get, you know, a sort of poppy, bubbly album here? That's not really what this is. It's really smooth in the production. Like, it really knocks constantly for two straight songs here. So let's let her keep talking her shit. I don't wanna talk at all. I honestly don't even got the time. I'm above that now. You know what this reminds me of? More of a pop lo-fi version of whatever Levine was to the 2000s, what her iconic entire era was. I know she's still doing her thing, still dropping new music. More of a ride the beat, less of a punk version of that. And I find that really interesting. I'm interested to see where we go with the rest of this.
Say you know more than I do, but what you never understand is I used to be such a fan, but now you're such a cool kid. It's like I don't even know you.
This is straight out of the Olivia Rodrigo vault. Oh my goodness. It's so interesting. All the different, you know, I've referenced Nelly on Don't Come Back. I referenced Avril Lavigne on I'm So Gone. Now I'm referencing Olivia Rodrigo on What Would You Do? These are three artists that live in three different worlds, and Tate's making me think immediately of these artists with these three songs so far, and that's a huge accomplishment for me personally, because those are, you know, three that are as big as it gets. Build it up.
Don't get too comfortable, cause I might not be there next time you turn around. So
I love this girl. And then she ends up with that run right there. Do it again. Okay, this is so fast. This is such a fascinating start, because I mentioned Avril after I'm So Gone, but that was as Avril as it gets, and you know, Olivia obviously draws a lot of inspiration from Avril, so it was also as Olivia in turn as it gets. It was almost hard to not feel like I was living inside of an Olivia Rodrigo song listening to that. That's just a personal thing for me, because I've just listened to so much of Olivia's music the past year plus now. I love the jumpiness of all this so far. Like, I felt like we were grooving, knocking, you know, to tracks 2 and 3, but then 4 is kind of a bit jumpier. Like, you can't really just keep still and swallow in the sounds of this sort of very specifically dedicated to kind of fuck my ex songs so far.
And I guess they're my friends right now, we got nothing in common. But being lonely's worse than just having friends who don't care.
Yeah.
You said it looks like I've been going through hell. How did you know? I'm trying my best, yeah, to be brutally honest. Nobody said change, it would be this exhausting. A foot on the brake, cause it's been making me car sick. How could you blame me growing up?
Wait.
Nobody said change, it would be this exhausting. A foot on the brake, cause it's been making me car sick. How could you blame me?
Oh, the foot on the brake, making me car sick, even though the foot on the brake is more of a metaphor for, you know, how she's feeling in this situation. Really cool lyric. Like, that's the best use of a metaphor I've heard her use so far lyrically.
I'm trying my best, yeah, to be brutally honest. Nobody said change, it would be this exhausting. How could you blame me going off this game?
Yeah, which blends in perfectly with the album title.
I'm just blowing all this shit up in my head, but I can help it. No, I can help it. Put on the brake, cause it's making me car sick. How could you blame me?
Oh, I love the you kind of expect another line, another couple lines, maybe even that chorus one last time, but she kind of cuts it off and sort of leaves you with that longing for more, which the song makes me feel that way in general with what she's singing about here. I'm glad that we got this song in this moment, because I was hoping we'd slow it down and get more of a ballad type song, especially after so many tracks of just like attack, 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 fuck this guy, time to talk my shit, and rightfully so, right? You get it off your chest, girl, you let it out. Songs that knock, songs that just make me want to move, and I wanted to hear her vocal, particularly because that vocal continued to stay spunky during 2, 3, and 4. It continued to make me feel like, yeah, she really means like what she's saying about these maybe different situations, even though they all sound like they might be the same situation. It was a different tone here in Chaotic. There was hurt. There was a lot of sadness in her vocal there that I hadn't heard yet. As opposed to sort of a lot of maybe just like anger and regret in the other ones. Hate Myself is track 6. I also love the reference, by the way, which ties in the growing up, which ties in exactly with I used to think I could fly. Hate Myself, track 6. Also, I want to point out really quick about that last track too, because I've already went ahead and made like 3 comparisons on this album, and now that I'm that far in, I'm just gonna go ahead and do another one. Gave me a fourth artist here, and I was very much thinking of Camila Cabello during Chaotic. She had a little bit of that in her vocal. So yeah, you've got a Nelly, you've got Avril Lavigne, Olivia Rodrigo, Camila Cabello. You're doing something right.
People get too close to me, don't know where it comes from, honestly. And you weren't perfect, yeah, you had your lows, but I'd say you got pretty close. Don't know how you could put it up with me.
I want to hear more of this from her. I've heard it a couple times, but I'm not quite getting as much as I'd like. When she says here on lows, just the way she drags the note out, you know, the way it's a little bit of a riff, mid-word. She's got a lovely voice, and I just would like to hear her play with words more.
Perfect, yeah, you have your lows.
Right there. Listen to how nice that sounds.
Perfect, yeah, you have your lows. But
more of that.
I didn't think this over. Fell back when you got closer. After I just put you right through hell. You couldn't hate me more than I hate myself.
Wow, it's interesting to hear. First of all, I love that. I'll get into it on the next chorus, actually. I assume that's the chorus and she'll say it again. But I love the other end of it, the accountability aspect of it, because it's been sort of taking it out on, you know, this other former partner, but now she's sort of flipping it onto the part that she had to deal with internally in her own choices.
When you said that you just couldn't take it, that I would lose you for good. Oh, I didn't think this over. Fell back when you got closer. I'd always act so selfish. Okay. And shit I hadn't dealt with. After I just put you right through hell, you couldn't hit me more than I hate myself.
I love that I acted so selfish at shit that I didn't deal with. That shit that I should have dealt with, however she worded it. I love that phrasing. I love that being able to look back and realizing that the stuff you didn't deal with and how it affected others completely aligns itself with what selfishness is. And I love the way she articulates that. It's probably my favorite song lyrically on the album so far. I'm really locked into these lyrics here.
I didn't think this over. Fell back when you got closer. After I just put you right through hell, you couldn't hate me more than I hate myself.
So it's probably my favorite song lyrically. On the album so far, she is throwing curse words out left and right. Shout out to her for that. Shout out to her for that, for not like spending too much time thinking about, you know, appeasing. I'm sure like she sent this to the label and they were probably like, hey, you know, it's a lot of curse words. And I hope that that actually happened. And I hope that she was like, I don't care. This is the way that I was feeling. This is the way I wrote it down. This is exactly how my emotions dictated it. All right, what's your problem, track 7?
Your problem, you think that you're a god. You came and fucked my life up when you knew that I was lost. What's your problem? I'm crying on the floor. You made me hate myself just so that I would love you more.
Oh, oh.
I don't give a fuck about you.
Oh, you hate me. Oh.
So that I would love you more. What's your problem? I'm crying on the floor. You made me hate myself just so that I would love you more.
Man, you made me hate myself just so that I would love you more. Wow, that is a twisted web of fucked upness.
I should've known when my mom said she don't like you. She took that as a sign.
That's a big sign.
Thought I got you smiling. Cause that shit gives you high. What's your problem?
Oh, this is probably my favorite song. I could love you more.
Tried to make me more like you and less like me. You're saying things I won't repeat. This petty shit only you do.
Oh, I love that saying shit I won't repeat, which is interesting because she's been pretty not hesitant to dig into the stuff that was going on and to sort of put these exes in the light, you know, like, you did all this, and I'm gonna make sure I put it out there. So for her to have a line where she says saying shit I won't repeat makes me think even deeper and darker into what she was going through in these scenarios. Like, now you have to make up the situations in your head, and because she's already been so, you know, pretty transparent about the situations and how she felt about them, it really makes you think, like, damn, like, how much worse could it have been? Pretty much in this song, she's been gaslighted the whole time, manipulated into being a different person. And man, this is my favorite song on the album so far.
Cause that shit gives you high. What's your problem? You think that you're a god. You came and fucked my life up when you knew that I was lost. Self just so that I would love you more. What's your problem?
Oh man, go ahead with the What's your problem? My favorite track on this album so far. Yep. And I'm looking at streams, by the way, and what's your problem? Justice. Okay, can we elevate that one in terms of streams with some of these bigger songs? Speaking of bigger songs, this one's got the most on the album. She's All I Want to Be, track 8.
Someone who's out every weekday in her dad's new car. You tell me I shouldn't stress out. Say it's not that hard. Why'd you close your eyes when you said it out?
Oh, observant.
Stupid boy making me so
Okay, I'm gonna make a complaint. I can see why this song has all the streams it does. It's already got me feeling like, you know, like I want to just like rock out, groove to it. I want her vocals to be a lot more aggressive here, and I know she can do it. Like I heard it was there on What's Your Problem. She's done it on this album. She's got a great voice, and I feel like she should have gone more aggressive here. She already went all the way with the drums and the guitars. A grittier, more growly, more just however you want to put it, just more anger is what I want to hear on this.
Why'd you close your eyes when
this is great? That's great, but right here.
Stupid boy making me so sad.
Yeah, because like it's the stupid boy making me so sad. Even that's it sounds too nice. Like it sounds like you're just taking it too easy on it. Like that's, I know that that's not how you felt when you wrote this song. And now I feel like I'm wanting more vocally from him when I know she can already sing her ass off.
Ooh. So
I like that.
She's got everything that I don't have.
I like this. I like all that a lot. It's hard. I got pulled out of the song by wanting more. I just wanted a little bit more vocally, and I know she can do it. I've already heard it on the album, so I guess that's where a little bit of the disappointment, I guess, comes from with that track. And it's the most popular track on the album, and I can see why. You know, it's got that really upbeat, it's got that front, that radio friendly. Maybe that's why they didn't go all the way with it. I don't know, who knows. And you know, maybe this is just my opinion, could be totally in the minority for all I know. Boy X, track 9.
And nobody in.
Mm-hmm.
Thought if she never gave her heart away, never end up broken.
Mm-hmm.
But boy, yes, across the street, oh, he was one of a kind. Made her fall in love with only just a look in her eyes. When next time you move on,
oh,
like I know you do.
Wow.
Promise you, promise things you know just won't come true. And don't you dare make her feel like she's the only.
Oh, give me that vocal again, Tate. Hold up. Don't do that stupid thing with your eyes unless you mean it.
Only that you let her go before you look for someone new.
Man, wow, tell me that you'll let her go before you look for someone new. She just took us through a journey. She took us from the start and built up the whole story from the beginning, from her just completely putting this wall up, making sure that she wouldn't let anybody in. Like, it was all very intentionally done so that she could protect that part of herself. And then Boy X across the street just, you know, lied, did these things with his eyes that he didn't really mean, made promises he didn't mean, said things he didn't just, and also took on another partner while he was with her. And She said a lot, and then to end it like that too, she literally takes us through a timeline essentially. Man, this is probably my second favorite song lyrically on the album, probably after Hate Myself, if that was the one I had mentioned before. This is one of my favorite songs in the album as well. Okay, let's keep going.
Whoever was dead, left her holding up the pieces of her heart by a thread. He left her there. Next time you move on, like I know you do, things you know just won't come.
I love her voice on here.
They make her feel like she's the only.
Such a good choice. Her voice on this song makes me even angrier at She's All I Wanna Be, because she's matching the tone, like the emotional arc of what this song is supposed to be telling, the story that this song is supposed to be telling emotionally. She is matching that to a T vocally on here. It was not that at all, and She's All I Wanted to Be. So now I'm just getting even more frustrated with that song that I just thought that I should have loved. This I love.
There's a billion of Boy X, but babe, there's only one of me.
Oh, yeah, yeah, it's the classic there's a million fish in the sea line, but you accompany that line with, you know, protecting yourself. It's much more than just basically saying, like, oh, there'll be another one. It's like, there's so many of those, but there's really only one of me. I need to protect myself. It kind of brings it back to the beginning, where she tried to protect herself but quite couldn't. But then you have to figure out the balance of that, the balance of protecting yourself but also allowing yourself to love and be loved, which she's kind of touched on in this song already with, I think it was Hate Myself, right, where she was speaking on her own regrets and her own sort of dealings with the mistakes that she made. So I find that Boy X is such a standout moment on this album for me. I actually feel like the second half of the album is feeling a little stronger. You're So Cool, track 10. Could you go on a date with yourself? Oh, you think that you're so fucking cool. But all your best friends really hate you too. Hey, Tate, I adore your ability to, your lack of ability to censor yourself. I just love how transparent you are with how you feel about the situation in hindsight and looking, being able to look back at it for what it is and tell it like what it is. I love that. Okay. She's feeling herself here. You're doing well, yeah. Anywhere you control me. I love, again, just her straightforwardness with it. I love how she played with her vocals on that song. I love that she was feeling herself, and you can tell she was feeling herself vocally in that booth. Yeah, really, really solid track on here. Feel like shit track 11. But it's been a couple weeks now, and I still feel stuck in my lungs. And usually I go out on nights, and I think of you once. Thought I'd be done with the hardest part when I pulled myself out of your arms. Wish I knew that was only the start. Oh, lyrics. I'll be done with us. Well, first of all, you give me that vocal run right there and you go into lyrics. Really thought I'd be done with the hardest part. And so, she's so talented. Because really thought I'd be done with the hardest part, right? But that doesn't fit perfectly into the melody. You have to extend hardest. How does she extend hardest? She turns hard, she sings hard, and she adds like a whole extra syllable in there with her voice. And you can only pull that off when you've got a voice like this. She can do a lot with her vocals, and it's real. It's as the album gets deeper and deeper, I'm really growing a really profound appreciation for what she can do vocally. Listen to just what she does and take the riff away in a hardest that she does. It doesn't fit in the melody, but she makes it fit, which is something that the best rappers in the world are really good at, that kind of thing, fitting, extending, pronouncing a word differently and adding a completely extra syllable that shouldn't be there so they could fit into their rhyme scheme. It's almost even harder to do it as a singer to fit that into your melody, and listen to how she does it. When I pull myself out of your arms, really thought I'd be done with the hardest part. I love that. It's so tastefully done, and it's not something you're gonna hear on a lot of albums. Hardest part. When I pull myself out of your arms, wish I knew that was only the start. And I'm falling apart, cause man, I love it. Just lyrically too, just you thought that would be the hardest part, pulled myself out of your arms, but no, it's really just getting started. And maybe I'll get used to it, but right now I just feel like shit. Oh, we're telling a story. Listen to the timeline of events. I I'm really impressed with her ability to write her lyrics in a timeline. She continues to do that. She did it in Boy X exquisitely. She just did it again in Feel Like Shit, where the lyrics change subtly, but it's an important subtlety because the timeline shifts and different things are happening. It's illustrating exactly what she went through. I just think it's so well done. That's one of my favorite songs on the album. Go Away, track 12. Okay, reference to the album. You should be, things are good. Man, her voice. I like that we got that line twice, because I think that that's an important line. I should feel on top of the world, but I'm not dealing with this. And I think it goes to show that, you know, this is an up-and-coming star, right? Tate McRae, this is her debut album. As she's writing this, I'm sure she probably had already released the EPs that she had released. She had already signed her record deal. She had already had the huge, I think, what was it, 2017? She had like her huge hit that kind of went viral there. She should be on top of the world. That's the feeling she should have. But she's dealing with the reality of real life experiences and emotions and relationships. And I just love that it makes you think deeper into the fact that, you know, even people that have these opportunities, they're wonderful opportunities, that they're also dealing with real life shit. I was driving and I thought that I saw you in the almost crash. The sad part is if the roles were reversed, you would have drove right past. Oh. Cause every time look at me, it's not. She almost crashed because she was trying to stop. She like, you know, slammed on her brakes, or which there was a car reference and slamming on the brakes reference earlier in the album, by the way. We're catching that. She interlocking her message throughout. This is why I love listening to these albums together from these ridiculously talented artists and songwriters. Go ahead, Tate. I see what you're doing there. She almost crashed because she was going to stop for, she thought she saw him, was going to stop for him, even though she's dealing with all these emotions. If it was him, though, if he had saw her, he would just drive right past. Some really, the second half of this album's got some strong songwriting. Man, I love her showing off vocally here. I want to say that these last four songs, Boy X, You're So Cool, Feel Like Shit, and Go Away, are all my favorite songs from her vocally, which is interesting because there's a bunch of songs in the first half where I was really feeling out her voice, and now it makes me want to go back and re-listen to those songs. When I say feeling out her voice, it was still very impressive, but I was making comparisons, and she was reminding me of certain artists with some of the vocal inflections, but now I'm in a place where I'm just very, very, very impressed, to the very least. Okay, let's close this out. I still say goodnight. Track 13. You stopped saying goodnight. That was the first sign that you were letting go. That's so significant. That's so real, by the way. No, you don't. The slow drift away. See me the same way. I don't believe. I feel so stupid. Cause I still say goodnight. And the songwriting on that I Still Say Goodnight represents I Still Say Goodnight, Black and White. It represents even more than that. It represents everything. It represents how she is consistent, how she is still looking at this relationship as she did in the beginning. You know, she's still carrying out her end. She still has all the feelings. She still wants, you know, the same things that they probably agreed to want in the beginning, that he is no longer, you know, has that foot in the relationship. She still has her foot in. He's got both his feet out. That I still say goodnight. You could take out goodnight and say, like, I still everything. You know, I still am here. That's so clever to me, because that I still, that goodnight that she's talking about in the song here, that represents so many things. But the literal part of it is such a real thing, you know, right? When you're in a relationship with someone that I assume you see and you have like a regular healthy relationship, but say you don't live together. I'm gonna assume they don't live together. It's pretty normal procedure in a healthy relationship to text your partner, you know, hey, good night. Probably every day. And then they reach the point where he's not doing that anymore. And it's a lot of like those little things that you can see someone start to slowly drift away. She referenced that she had the look in his eye when he's about to lie. And that's something she's mentioned actually in the song prior, particularly with that eye, with the look that person would have in their eye, where she just knows she's about to get a bunch of bullshit. She's in the drift away part of the relationship where he's drifting, and that's a really tough place to be. And I love her delivery vocally on this, because it just is so perfect for what she's singing about here.
I so dressed up and you never seem to care. You're ridiculous.
It's interesting because she's probably older than Billie Eilish, because Billie Eilish, it's crazy what Billie Eilish, it's crazy is not the word. It's fucking insane what Billie Eilish has managed to accomplish at such a young age. Like, it doesn't make any sense at all. I have to remind myself. But I can feel, and I'm doing more comparison because I'm already this deep in. You can just feel Billie Eilish influence on this song. Not only that, there's so many artists that I've been listening to recently, whether it be a Tate or a Gracie Abrams or a Lizzie McAlpine or Olivia Rodrigo. But this song in particular here, there's just Billie Eilish has really left such a significant impact on a lot of what we hear now from particularly from up and coming pop artists, and that cannot be denied, the impact that this young woman Billie has had.
I know that look you get when you're about to lie. I feel so stupid. I still say goodnight.
I really feel like this album picked up a lot in the second half. Just having said that, there's still plenty of songs in the flake. That track 2-4 run is a run that I want to go back to really bad, because number one, I love how I just wanted to like move throughout those songs so much, and it was a lot less of that in the second half of the album, and a lot more sort of I feel like storytelling a lot. Like, I feel like she got a lot of stuff off her chest in that first half, a lot of energy out. In the second half, we got more into the storytelling, we got more into the emotions, we got more into her mind a little bit, even though this whole album is her not holding back whatsoever, and that's from the start. That's been consistent from the start. I'll give my top five while we're here on this album, in no particular order, by the way, guys. I mean, my favorite song on this album is probably What's Your Problem Still, but Boy X and Feel Like Shit really, really came in hard. My top five in this album are Don't Come Back, What's Your Problem, Boy X, Feel Like Shit, and I Still Say Goodnight. I'm gonna put in that top five. A couple other ones are pretty close up there, but I'm gonna stick with that. I'm really impressed by Tate. She's got incredible control of her vocal. She can do so many different things. You know, this album doesn't feel like a debut album as so much as it feels like someone that has just had a lot of shit to get off of their chest. You know what I mean? And I really like that feeling. I like feeling that as we reach the end of it, where I'm not like, oh, okay, debut album, let me think about a debut album and sort of like what some of the standards and expectations are for that. I'm not really thinking about that at all. I'm more so thinking about how I feel a lot closer to Tate McRae and the stuff that she's been through. And again, I mentioned that a lot of the songs end, particularly sort of beginning to towards the track 9 or 10-ish, where they feel like there's no resolution. And a lot of that really excites me because it makes me, again, really look forward to the rest of what her career is going to look like, to what the next album looks like after she goes through this monster tour she's about to go on to, right? She's got so much more to experience in life, and I can't wait to see what comes of that. I'm a fan of her, I'm a fan of this album. I love her voice, I love her songwriting, I love her deliberateness, if that's even a word, with how she feels. God, do I adore her. That's probably my favorite part of this whole record. And I love this "I used to think I could fly" concept, and sort of comparing that feeling to what she feels as we close this album now, as we close this album out. So, Tate McRae, "I used to think I could fly." Go stream the album, guys. And thanks for watching.